Well, good morning and welcome to our all-age service of worship. We are so glad that you are able to join us. Today we're going to be continuing on with our series from James. We're going to be talking about faith and speech. But before we start the service, let's just pray, shall we, and give the service to God. And so, Father, we thank you for this new day. And God, I pray that today that you'd give us ears to hear and hearts to receive what you want us to hear this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you.
St. Mary's and St. Mark's News Channel. Today we are looking at what James tells us about the importance of our speech and how our words have the power to tear people down or build them up and encourage them. So let's get to it.
Can you give an example of when someone else's words have encouraged you?
Yes. When I was home learning, I made a presentation.
My teacher said it was really professional and she could use it to teach her next class. This made me really pleased with what I had achieved.
Thank you. Hello, Dave. Can you think of a time when someone has said something that has given you life or encouraged you?
Hello, Olivia. Yes. I can remember a time when I was without a lot of faith. I can remember a time when I was feeling lost, unloved. And someone said to me, just look around you and see all that God is providing for you. So now, whenever I'm down, I count my blessings and think, what a wonderful world God has given us to live in. Okay? Is that okay?
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
Okay, has there been a time when somebody else's words have helped you with your faith?
Yes, I've been given lots of special verses in my life that have really helped me through different times. I remember one time I was at university and a speaker had come to visit RCU, and she actually gave me an amazing word where she actually told me all about a dream that only my family knew about, because it was a dream that my dad had, and it really spoke into a situation that I was dealing with. And I think when I was 14, I became a Christian, and it was because I saw people putting their faith and the words from the Bible into action, and that really, really strengthened my faith, and yeah, brought me to sort of was a step in bringing me to know Jesus.
I'm now here with Abigail, and I would like to know how she feels when people say kind things to her. So, how do you feel when people say kind things to you, Abigail?
Happy.
Why does it make you feel happy?
Because they make me feel really good about myself.
So, let's learn from what James says and use our words to encourage others and build them up. Maybe you could think about how you could use your words to encourage someone in their faith today. Thanks for watching. Bye! Hi, welcome to the St. Mary's and Sea. Toby, can you give an example of when...
Toby's my...
Hi, welcome to the St. Mary Took a Breath, St. Mark's News Channel. Today we are looking at what...
James chapter 3 verses 1 to 18. Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and driven by such strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course of his life on fire, and itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles and creatures of the sea are being tamed, and have been tamed by man. But no man can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbour bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly and spiritual of the devil. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you will find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your eternal and unchanging word, and we invite you now to speak it afresh by your Holy Spirit through me and into our very hearts, each one of us, that we may speak and live for you in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you remember that old nursery rhyme? Sticks and stones may hurt my bones, but words can never hurt me. Well, it's absolute nonsense, of course. James says words are powerful and dangerous. Words can scar people for life. What do you think this is? It's a horse's bit. And this? It's a boat's rudder. What about this? It's a matchstick. That was easy enough, wasn't it? And this one? What have they all got in common? Well, all right, I admit I cheated a bit on that last one. How about this? Yes, they're both mice, aren't they? A mouse. These are all things which are small in themselves, but they can have the most enormous influence over things which are much bigger than they are. So the bit controls a mighty horse, like this. The rudder directs a whole boat, like this. And a matchstick can be responsible for a devastating fire, like this. And the mouse? Well, James has been writing about those who may be very good at talking the talk, but fail to deliver when it comes to walking the walk. So in chapter 2 of his letter, he considers the case of a man telling people in need to go and be kept warm and well-fed, but failing to give them anything that will make that a reality. He says it's no good professing faith if it isn't real in practice. And that leads him on to think about the things we say generally. The fact is that, verse 2 of our chapter, we all stumble in many ways. By the way, it's always a good idea to have your Bibles handy when you're joining in an online service. So one of the areas where we find it most difficult to get things right consistently is in this whole business, not just of what we do, but of what we say. And in our generation, it's even more difficult because for us, it isn't just the problem of the tongue, it's also that of the mouse. At least when we were tempted to write unkind things in a letter, there used to be time to reflect before it went off in the post. Now, something presses our buttons and bing, our lower nature reacts and the hurtful message has gone out into the ether. Somebody tweets something to somebody else's discredit and we agree and we send it on to our friends. And before one knows it, a huge tide of pain has washed up on someone's shore, like this, inspiring either rage and retaliation or else despair and thoughts of suicide. The internet reflects human nature in both its good and its bad aspects and magnifies and multiplies it many times over. Never has there been such a good demonstration of what James meant when he likened the tongue to a little match that could ignite terrifying forest fires, such as we saw a few months back in Australia. Never has it been so important for Christians to recognize the damage that can be done by a carelessly dropped word and to halt that process, to be those who put out the fires, to be, verse 18, peacemakers. Tolkien called the place where the Lord of the Rings is set Middle Earth. And that works as a good description of where you and I and all humanity live. Middle Earth, the battlefield between the two spiritual realms of heaven and of hell. Verses 6 and 15 of our passage. The things that we do and say, everything that we do or say, will further the cause of one side or the other. And as we go through life, there'll be words and actions that impact us, which have been set on fire, verse 6, or poisoned, verse 8, by the devil. And in an instant, our emotional instinct is to strike back because of the injustice we perceive. I shouldn't have been treated that way. It's so unfair. They shouldn't get away with that. I'm not putting up with that. And you may well be right that whoever it is has behaved really badly towards you. It may be an offence against God and man. And I'm afraid if you're anything like me, you'll be able to persuade yourself that because God doesn't like it either, he wants you to retaliate in kind and show them where they jolly well get off. But that is all part of the enemy's strategy. When Jesus was attacked, 1 Peter 2 verse 23, he did not retaliate. He said, "Father, forgive them, but they don't know what they're doing." He soaked up all the pain and gave out love instead. If you have asked Jesus to be the Lord of your life, then you have his Holy Spirit within you. And that means you have a choice. You don't have to allow your negative reactions to kick in. There is a power in you that is greater than your pain or anger or envy or ambition. It is the resurrection power of the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, the greatest force in the universe. So in this passage, James chapter 3, we're shown two processes at work, the hell sequence and the heavenly sequence. The hell sequence runs like this. Starting out from hell, your reactions will be, verse 14, ones of selfish ambition and bitter envy. Well, why should they get away? Why should they have that? Why shouldn't I? And then that leads on to boasting and denial of the truth. Keep on checking. Am I perhaps just bending the facts a bit in my own favour? Am I presenting myself a bit more favourably than the facts really justify deep down? And then from there it's downhill all the way towards verse 16, disorder and every evil practice. It's a helter-skelter all the way to hell itself. And many people, tragically, find themselves in effect choosing that by default because it is the default position of humanity ever since the fall. But if you are united with Jesus, you have the power of choice. You can choose all the time to follow the heavenly sequence. And that starts with a godly wisdom that, verse 17, is pure. That means it's not coming from mixed motives. The question to ask in every situation is this. Is this how Jesus would respond in these circumstances? Before you allow yourself to speak what is coming to your lips or to click send, check. Would the Prince of Peace be doing this? Secondly, is what I am about to do considerate of the feelings of others? Because it's no good my complaining about their insensitivity if I'm just going to do the same thing myself. And even though I don't believe I did, perhaps they thought I behaved badly towards them, and that's why they're reacting as they have. Thirdly, is what I'm about to do submissive? Oh, that's a tricky one, isn't it? Submissive? Me? To that so-and-so? But Jesus submitted to the injustice of the cross. In fact, the King James Version translates this word easy to be entreated. So at the very least, we have to be fully open to discussion on the subject. Fourthly, will what I am about to do result in mercy and good fruit? Or will it just ramp things up further? Fifthly, am I being impartial and sincere? Or am I trying to be judge and jury and come to that executioner in my own cause? You'll notice that the question isn't whether or not they're behaving fairly towards you or even whether you are treating them fairly. No, it's about our going way beyond that, as Jesus did. And if once you have stopped to draw on godly wisdom, then the heavenly sequence continues in humility, good actions, a good life. And then, verse 18, you will be a peacemaker. And from your peaceful response will come a harvest of righteousness. Well, that's the choice. In the end, on this great battleground of Middle Earth, you are helping one side or the other. And the worst thing is to be a turncoat, fighting sometimes on one side and sometimes on the other. Jesus, our captain, came to win and woo and heal damaged souls who have never known the peace he offers. It will be difficult trying to tell him how much you were really on his side when he points out the damage you did to his campaign by your wounding words that hurt others. Every time you say or do something hurtful to other people, you are wounding Jesus. Wouldn't it be worth accepting some injustice against yourself if by doing so you can prevent a blow from landing on your loving Saviour who gave his life for you? Let alone dealing him such a blow yourself. Words drive people to suicide. Words scar people for life. Your words connect up to the whole spirit world, so that what you say about someone may act as a curse on them, a blight invoking evil. Or you have the power to pronounce a blessing on them, calling down heaven to work on their lives. It may seem only the tiniest little thing, like a rudder on the back of a ship, or a bit in the mouth of a horse, or a matchstick, but you are possessed of a mighty, mighty power. How are you going to use it? Sometimes for Jesus and sometimes for the devil? Or are you going to resolve here and now to ask God to help you to set a watch on your tongue and help you to catch yourself before you say or write or tweet anything negative about anyone other than the devil himself? Are you a blessing or a curse? Let's pray. Oh Lord Jesus, thank you so much that you set us free from the tyranny of self. We know how quickly we react to injustice against ourselves or people being unkind. We know how easy it is to slip into unkindness, even unprovoked. And Lord, we are so sorry for that. Thank you, Jesus, that you died on the cross to deal with our sin, to take it down to hell forever, and you rose again to give us a new life of your love and your truth. So Lord, we choose you. Live your life in and through us, we pray. And may the words we speak be words of blessing and anointing and love. In Jesus' name. Amen.
May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart bless your name, bless your name, Jesus. And the deeds of the day and the truth in my way speak of you, Jesus. For this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything I have and follow you. I'll follow you. Though will you be my vision, though will you be my guide, be my hope, be my light and the way. And I look not for riches or praises on earth, only you'll be the first of my heart. For this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give I will follow you. this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything I have and follow you. This is what I'm glad to do.
Together this morning, we remember before you those who suffer stress and anxiety from lack of work. Guide those who are struggling to provide and those lacking from your word to find public and private wealth, and that all may find suitable and fulfilling employment. Give these people confidence and courage to search for jobs and to find a source of income. So we commend in your goodness all those who are afflicted or distressed in body, mind or soul, that you grant them comfort and relief according to their needs, granting them patience in their suffering. We pray for relief of the conflict involving racism and for an end to discrimination in all its forms, that each person may be respected and valued as a child of God, and that the church may be a witness and a universal sign of unity among all people. We ask of you that you will lead us in decision making and give us the confidence to stand up for what is right.
We bring before you the bereaved and mourning. Bless those who mourn with the comfort of your love, that they may face each new day with hope and the certainty that nothing can destroy the good that has been given. We also pray for those suffering from the coronavirus and those whose relatives are also suffering. We pray for your intervention in the situation that we are in, for progress in research, and for wisdom for leaders all around the world. Speak to the hearts and minds of those who can influence and give them and us the awareness of poorer countries around the world. May they feel your presence with them always. We thank you for our many blessings which you provide for us each day, and we are sorry for straying from the correct path when we sin. Thank you for your amazing power and work in our lives, and we are grateful for your goodness and for blessings over us. Thank you for being able to bring hope through even the toughest of times, strengthening us for your purposes and for your great love and care. Lord, please forgive us for the times when we have sinned this week and the times when we have disobeyed your word and guidance.
Lord, as we rise to meet each new day, please let us be filled with your spirit. Wherever we go, let us spread love, joy, peace, goodness and faithfulness. Let us desire to become more like you and to worship you in all we do. Help us desire these things so much more than the sin that entices us, and lead us in the power of your spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ, the saving one. And we can see that God's moving, a mighty river through the nation, and young and old.
feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song, and all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness. And here we see that God, you're moving, that time of jubilee is coming, when young and old return to Jesus.
Thank you for joining us for this all-age service. We have loved having you with us this morning, but let's just close in prayer, shall we? So, Lord Jesus, we thank you for what we've just heard, God. And I pray that we would be able to this week put our hand in your hand and trust you with our whole heart that what you are doing in us is good. Yeah, Jesus, I pray that you would fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit. And God, that you would fill us with your love so that we would be able to pour out our love onto others and to those around us this week. Amen. And just to close, I have a short blessing. It's from the book of Numbers. I'm sure many of you have known it. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and may he give you peace. Amen.